Latifur Khan. I'm from University of Texas at Dallas. Today I will talk about some of our stream mining work. And this work is funded by NSF and Air Force in the past, and NASA also. And some of the work is in collaboration with University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign with Professor Johan's group. So I'm saying this work is funded by NSF in the past, and NASA and the Air Force. And some of the work is in collaboration with University of Illinois, Urbana-Champaign, with, in particular with Professor Johan's group. Okay, today, outline of my talk, first I will talk about data stream, what is data stream means. And then I will introduce you a new challenge there and what we are trying to solve it, what we call it concept evaluation, when the brand new class emerge in the stream, how we can detect that. And then I will present some of the shortcomings of the existing work. And then I will talk about some of our work. And then there is an issue with what we call it limited level learning. We are talking about classification, which will be a supervised task. You need a lot of ground truth. Can you hear? It's better now. So you need a lot of ground truth for the. So this is one problem in typical supervised learning. So we will try to address that issue using semi-supervised learning or active learning. I will talk about that a little bit. And then I will present some of our results, and then I will talk about some of the applications and future work. So let me introduce you what is the data stream means. Data stream means continuous flow of data. You can think about network data as an example of data stream. Then sensor network generates humongous amount of data. These are all examples of the data stream. So basically, data are continuously coming. So you want to do some sort of learning there. And this data stream will give you a huge amount of information. And from there, our goal is to extract the knowledge that will be useful for the decision making and so on. And a possible application, think about in the security domain. One particular application is like this. So you have a pointer. So here in this work, we focus on, let's say, when the traffic comes, I want to classify it whether it's benign or malicious. So in okay, so here the network traffic comes is a bunch of packets, header and the payload. And there is usually the firewall will filter unwanted traffic and so on. But still, firewall will not be enough to filter out malicious traffic. So here we will deploy, say, some sort of supervised learning classification technique. The technique will predict whether the traffic is benign or malicious. So if it is benign, then it will go to the server. If it is malicious, then we will block it and do the further analysis. So the key point here in this model or classification, whatever the learning technique you will use, SVM or decision tree, you need to update this model continuously. The reason is, let's say if you build a model at the beginning of the year, and if you try to continue use that model for 10 years or 20 years down the road, then in that case, this model will perform poorly over time. So you need to update this model continuously. Now the question is, how do you want to update? At which point you need to update it? So this is the key point in the stream classification area. So we need to address that issue. So stream is slightly different from the typical or traditional classification technique. There are first challenge it introduced called infinite length. So since data are continuously coming, you cannot assume that you can keep this raw data, entire raw data in the main memory. You can keep it in the disk, but you cannot keep all the raw data in the main memory. So which is a problem for the big data also. And the second problem, which we call it concept drift, characteristics of data will be changing over time. Let's assume that without loss of generality, we have a two-dimensional data. So this is a first weak data, let's say, and we have some ground truth. We build a model. In this case, this hyperplanar line will separate the positive instance from the negative instance. And then week 2 data comes, and if you try to use the old decision boundary to classify the points, you will say that below this, all of them will be positive class, above this will be negative class. But however, in the week 2, the characteristics of data are changing, so the new decision boundary should be like this. So in that case, if you use the old decision boundary, you will misclassify those blue points. So this slide is showing that you have to update the decision boundary frequently. And then third problem, already researcher addressed the concept drift at some extent. So the third problem is concept evaluation, so which is a what we call it novel class or emerging class appears in the stream. We want to detect that. So for example, let's say we have a bunch of training data points like this, and we build a model decision tree like this. So these are the rules. Now new test data comes like this, all this X. So in that case, this X will be classified as a positive class, and in this case, this X will be classified as a negative class. But what I'm trying to say here, this X should not form any, it should not be a part of the existing class. This X, existing class means positive class or negative class. This X should form a brand new class or novel class. So that's our goal, that we call it concept evaluation. So there are two ways. In typically stream classification domain, you can address the or you can do the classification. The first way is incremental learning. You build a model and then you continuously update with the incoming training data. Another approach is ensemble based technique. You will keep multiple models over time, and in the literature it shows that ensemble based technique is more effective. Therefore, in this work we focus on, in this presentation I will focus on the ensemble based technique. So from the ensemble you can understand that we'll keep multiple models or classifier over time. So here input data comes and the ensemble size is 3. So each of them will do a prediction, and a simple majority voting will tell that this is a positive class and so on. So this simple way you can do it. But you can also do the weighted voting, that's possible, but in the literature it shows it doesn't, the result doesn't differ that much. Now the question is, how do you want to update the model using in the ensemble based technique? So here is the idea. The idea is, first you build a, because it's supervised learning, you will build a model, and then when the test data comes, you will do the prediction, and over time you assume that you may have some ground truth, and then once you have a ground truth, you build a new model, and the existing model will be in the ensemble, some of the existing model will be replaced. So for example, if I have a week 1 data, week 2 data, week 3 data, and let's assume that first 3 week data we have the ground truth, we build the model M1, M2, M3, model means in this case the classifier, and then the ensemble size is 3, so 3 models we have. And now before the week 4 data comes, we have a set 1000 points there. We want to, each of the point want to do the prediction. So we'll take each of this point, and the ensemble will come up with a prediction with the majority voting. And time passes, you may have some ground truth on D4, so you will build a new model M4, and now M4 needs to be added here. So if you simply add M4 in the ensemble size will grow, so you have to make sure that ensemble size will not grow over time indefinitely, so, and also some of the model may not perform well. So you may need, so here the idea is how we, which one M4 will be replaced by what. So in this case we will see M1, M2, M3, which one is performing worse on the most recent training chunk. In this case M2 error is the highest among these 3, so M2 will be thrown away, M4 will be in. So that way we do the update, and we'll continue this way. And this way we can say that there are 3 challenges I introduce you. The first one, sorry for incoming. So here I'm saying I try to introduce 3 challenges. The first one is the infinite length issue. you cannot keep all the data in the main memory. So you divide the data into a number of chunks. Chunk means, let's say, first 1,000 instance will from the chunk 1, next 1,000 instance will from the chunk 2. So this way, you can address the infinite length issue, and then concept drift, since you are updating the model, so concept drift can be handled some extent. Now, the key problem is novel class detection or brand new class emerge, how we want to do it. So I want to introduce you a solution for that. So the solution is, we will use non-parametric method. So the idea is, the problem with the concept evaluation, why the existing work in the past existing work failed, because the way the decision boundary is constructed at the coarser grain. So we want to construct the decision boundary at the finer grain. So for that, these are the steps will be used. First step is for the training, so to construct the finer grain decision boundary. So I will explain that steps in details in a minute. And then second and third steps will be the outlier detection to find the novel class. Once you have an outlier, you cannot immediately say this is a brand new class. You have to take into consideration the other factors. So that I will talk about in step 3. Okay, so I try to tell you that. So the idea is this. You have a particular chunk, and you have some ground truth, and usually when you build the decision boundary, you will construct like this A, B, C, D, right? So then you will have a lot of unused space, and if the point falls into this area, you will say it's a positive class and negative class and so on. So that's why I'm saying this decision boundary is constructed at the coarser grain. So our goal is to construct at the finer grain. So for that, we will apply some sort of clustering algorithm, and here is the here we will use semi-supervised clustering algorithm. So semi-supervised means we will use we have some of the points have the class level, some of the points may not have a class level. So we will use all of them together when you build the clustering algorithm. And you know the typical clustering algorithm objective function is intro cluster distance will be minimized. So that one is a standard one, and plus we add the cluster impurity. If we have a ground truth or the class level, we will exploit that. So impurity means if you have a cluster has, let's say, 10 points, and out of these 10 points all are leveled, and 8 of them belongs to a positive class, and 2 of them belong to the negative class. In that case, impurity will be 20%. So that will be taken into consideration, and that we try to minimize this objective function and so on using EM algorithm that we try to do it here. And now, the idea is this. We have a bunch of points. Let's say in this case, we have 1,000 points, and 400 belongs to quadrant A, 400 belongs to here, and then 100 belongs to B and D quadrant. So now we want to build, let's say, for example, 100 clusters, K equal to 100. So in that case, proportionately, for A quadrant, we will build 40 clusters. For C quadrant, we will build 40 clusters, and B quadrant, we will build 10 clusters, and D quadrant, we will build 10 clusters. So all this way, we will proportionately build the number of clusters. And for the each of these pseudo clusters, we will keep the cluster centroid information, the radius, and then some other statistical information, and we'll discard all the raw data. So now, recall that I'm saying we have an ensemble-based technique here. So we have L number of models, and the test data comes. So for each of this model, we will keep doing this. So internally, we'll apply semi-supervised clustering and build the clusters and discard the raw data and so on. That way, we construct the finer grain decision boundary. When the test data comes, like for example, X. So in this case, this is a one model, let's say M, and this X is covered by one of this. Existing classes clusters. Therefore, this X will be treated as a existing class. On the other hand, this case, this X is not covered by any of this existing classes cluster. Therefore, X will be an outlier. But keep in mind that once you find an outlier, you cannot blindly say that this will form a brand new class. Brand new class may happen due in this case, when you detect the outlier, this outlier may happen due to the noise, due to the concept drift, or due to the concept evaluation. So we have to isolate those cases. So what we do here in this the work, and we refine it, you may say that this is a very rigid framework. So we have a test. If all of the models say this is an outlier, then we call it filtered outlier. Then we'll do further check whether it forms a brand new class or not. But if any of them say is not an outlier, then we will treat them as an existing class and classify accordingly. So now, the key point is once you have a filtered outlier, we will calculate the Shilwit coefficient. When you build a cluster, how do you justify that cluster is a high quality? The idea is you will calculate Shilwit coefficient property. So the cluster, whatever the points belong to that cluster, should be close to each other. Inter-cluster distance will be minimum, and the inter-cluster distance will be maximum, right? So we try to use that property here. So the key point is this. You can see here this black dots represents an outlier for a particular model, right? And then these are the positive class, these are the negative class, these are existing class instances. So now I'm saying this X are the outlier points, and I will call them this X, this black dots will form the novel class. The reason is these black dots are close to each other, and at the same time they are far away from the positive class and far away from the negative class instances. They are far away from the existing classes cluster. So I will, once I detect the outlier, the idea is this. You will first determine whether outliers, they're close to each other, and at the same time they are far away from the existing classes clusters. And if that the property holds, then we will say that this outlier points will form a brand new class. So for that we use the Q nearest neighborhood Shilwit coefficient. And so the idea is for each of these filtered outlier points, we will calculate the Q nearest neighborhood Shilwit coefficient. If this greater than 0 for at least Q number of points, then we call it brand new class. But you may, if you ask me, if you are in the stream, if I detect an outlier, and if the outlier has only 1 points eventually, and the rest of the non-outlier points, then this method will fail, because usually the Q is should be more than 1. Okay, and then there are a bunch of challenges we face with this algorithm, the way I presented. First, in some cases, it may give you a high false positive. In this case, high false positive means existing class instances will be declared as a novel class. Or if you have a question, you can interrupt me anytime. And then also, a false negative means some of the novel class will be classified as a existing class. So these are the performance issue we may encounter. So for that, and also the way I presented so far, we assume that when the novel class will emerge, it will emerge as a single novel class. But there is a possibility that two novel class may emerge simultaneously in the stream. So how do you want to tackle that issue? So for that, for the first issue, we try to update the decision boundary or the clusters spheres dynamically using some threshold. And then for the other part, we try to use we construct the graph and then identify how many components are there. And then there is another problem with this work, the way I presented so far. What we call it recurrence class will be treated as a novel class in the stream. So for example, what I meant, so this is a chunk 0, chunk 1, this is a black dot and negative, these are the classes, and then over time novel class emerges, and then you can see this black dot disappears in the chunk, and after a while it comes back again. So this we call it recurrence class. And in this case, so this recurrence class periodically comes. It comes at the beginning and disappears and reappears again after a while. So in that case, typical ensemble-based technique, the way we present it, it will not be able to detect this recurrence class as a recurrent. It will declare this class will be a novel class, because in the ensemble, we may not have any knowledge. So we try to address that issue in the past using keeping the additional ensembles. And if you use, instead of a chunk-based ensemble, if you use the class-based ensemble, then this problem will not be there. Recurrence problem will be solved. In other words, What I'm class based ensemble means, if we have so far, let's say you have 10 classes, so for each class you will keep multiple models. So in that case, even the recurrence class disappears, a class appears and disappears for a while, still it will be there. So then that issue will not be, then that recurrence issue will not be there. And now a couple of issues, the way I presented. The issue is, we assume that the chunk size is fixed, right? So this might be a problem. And there are a lot of work based on the fixed chunk size, and I try to say that the problem is, how do you set up the chunk size? And it may negatively affect the performance of the algorithm. If you set the chunk size too large, then what will happen? Let's say you set the chunk size thousands, and in a particular chunk, the concept drift happened after the first 100 instance. So in that case, since the chunk size, recall that chunk size is 1,000, so you have to wait additional 900 instance to pass, and then after that you will build a new model. So in that case, there is a possibility that you can misclassify a lot of points that come in the 900, among the 900 instances. So this is the problem when you set the chunk size too large. On the other hand, if you set the chunk size too small, then you may handle the concept drift well. But some cases, let's say there is no concept drift, in that case you are frequently updating the model. So that's where you are wasting your resources also. So this is one problem with the fixed chunk size. Finding the right chunk size is an issue. And then you may say, why don't you apply some decaying function, but then you have to estimate the decaying weight and so on. That's not easy. So is it possible we can set the chunk size dynamically? So that we try to address, and there are some work in that area. So let me show you graphically what is the problem with the fixed chunk size. So here you can see this third chunk is very large, and then so here this is the concept drift is happening, and then up to this 900 instances, the points will be very likely, a lot of points will be misclassified and so on. And then if you set the chunk size too small, then yes, you can address the concept drift, but if there is no concept drift, then you are wasting your resources. So can we do an adaptive chunk size, or set the chunk size dynamically? So for that, there is some work already by other groups, so I'll tell you in a minute. And this is more effective if we can determine the adaptive chunk size dynamically, or find the right chunk size. So existing work does this. So the idea is that there, the following. So they will have some. Yeah, well, it will improve the quality of the result. Improve means it will improve the accuracy, ROC curve, AOC curve, those types of things. But there is a trade-off also, because usually dynamic chunk size or adaptive chunk size is computationally expensive to determine on the fly.
Also, you are not comparing the same.
No. Yeah, so in one case, one window, it might be, say, 1,000 instance, another window maybe 3,000 instance, another third window maybe 500 instance. There is a possibility, yes. But the advantage is, let's say if you don't have any concept drift for a while, then you can use your existing model continuously. Then you don't need any ground truth. Once you update the model, that means what? You will ask the human annotator or somewhere to give you the label data, because you have to update the model. So there is an advantage of using the dynamic chunk size. If you can feel that whatever the model you are applying to do the prediction, that doesn't need to be changed. So in that case, you will not ask the human or annotator to provide the ground truth. So that way you can save the ground truth. But once you feel that your model is not doing well, at that point you need the ground truth. So that's the spot you will ask the human or some guy to provide the annotation or label data. Okay, so there is some work. That is a very good question. So the idea is this. Okay, idea is the following. So you have, at the beginning, you will start with a small window size, and you will see the system will do the prediction, And then you assume in this model, some other guys work, Gamma et al. And Biffett, they assume that you will provide the system will have the ground truth because you will estimate the error in the window. If you see that over time in the window error is going up significantly, then you can say that your classifier is not performing well. At that point, you need to retrain the model. So the problem here is this approach works well, but the problem is you assume that you need to estimate the error. Since you need to estimate the error, it means you need a level data. So it's a fully supervised model. So this is the bottleneck here. So we try to suggest different approach, which we call it unsupervised to determine the chunk size. Instead of relying on the error, we will rely on the confidence of the classifier or confidence of the ensemble. So when the test data comes, you know that the ensemble will come up with a prediction, and along with it will come up with some sort of confidence. So we will exploit that confidence. So the idea is over window, you will see if the confidence, classifier confidence doesn't change that much, or classifier is very confident over time, then we say that we don't need to do any retraining. But if we see that classifier confidence is going down over time significantly, then we can say that we may need to retrain the model. So this is very basic idea here. So for that, what we do, let's say we have at this point window has n number of points, and we try to determine whether the classifier confidence is going down or not. So recall that each of this test data you will have a confidence. So first in the window n, for the first point we'll have the confidence c1, for the second point confidence c2, and so on. So we will try to determine whether there is a before that, is there any change happening in terms of the confidence distribution. So let's say the change we are trying to determine at kth point, is there any change happen or not. So before the change, we call it distribution before the change and distribution after the change. If there is a significant change before and after, differ significantly, then we call it there is a change happening, we need to update the classifier, and in that point we will start from the beginning again the window size at the beginning with a smaller window. Otherwise, if there is no change, then we will increase the window and continue to look for change. So now you may ask me, how do I determine the confidence? So this is the key point. How many minutes are? So first, so you may ask me, how do I determine the confidence? So recall that our model is ensemble, so we have t number of models. So here the idea is, when you do the prediction, we will have a predicted class along with the confidence, but this confidence will be calculated based on the each of the internally in the ensemble, we have a teeth model. So each of the model has a confidence plus based on the this confidence, the classifier or the model's confidence will be calculated based on the training data. And then for the with respect to test data, you will have an association, and purity will give some sort of weight. And multiplying these two weight will come up with a classifier confidence. And then we have a T number of model, we'll take the average, and that average will be the ensemble's confidence. So let me explain this in details, what does it mean, the association and purity. So for each testing instance X, the confidence of a particular ith model will be calculated based on this. So HIX and ZI, ZI is the basically the weight of the classifier. And HIX is a vector of estimating values on test instance X, and AI is the association, how close with respect to the clusters we built. And if it is closer to the cluster centroid, then this AI value will be higher. If it is far away or the borderline points in the clusters, then it will be the weight will be this AI value will be less. And if we will also take into consideration the purity. If the cluster is very pure, then it should have a higher value. So that we try to use it here. So here H is be the closest cluster for a data instance X in the model MI, then the confidence association will be calculated based on this property. So I'm trying to say that if X is closer to this cluster centroid, then this value will be higher, and the purity will be, if the cluster is more pure, then it should carry higher weight. So that way we try to capture this. And then how do you estimate each of the models confidence? So for that we rely on the training instance K, and the training instance we have the ground truth, recall that. So same way we will calculate for each of this training instance the HI, and then we have the ground truth there. If there is an agreement we will put 1, if there is no agreement we will put 0, and then we would calculate the correlations. And so once you have a correlation values based on this association and the purity vector, and that way we'll generate the vector, and then we'll normalize it, and then we just to take that dot product, and that way we'll end up with a 1 confidence values. You can do in various ways. We observe that this is more effective way to do it, and that paper was published in ICD and AAAI this year. And now, so once you have the confidence, how do you want to determine that? So window-based technique, so there is and the window is dynamically growing or shrinking. So the idea is we need to determine whether there is a change happens in the confidence or not. So keep in mind, we try to model the confidence value using the beta distribution. Why is beta distribution? If you plot this y-axis represents probability density values, and the x-axis represents the confidence values. So if there is a no concept drift, that means no concept drift means in a particular window, what you will observe? You will observe the high confidence values. So in that case, you will see the most of the probability density function follows this type of pattern. So 0.8, lot of values should be there. But if there is a concept drift is going on in the window, then what will happen? You will have lot of confidence value which will have a lower numbers fall into this area. So that will be captured by this red line. So this is the way we determine the probability density function using beta distribution. And here is the approach. We do borrow the idea from the statistics, what we call it Q-sum process in the change detection. And the idea here is this. We have in the window, we want to determine whether there is any change happens or not. So if there is no change, then the window will increase by 1. If there is a change, then we will restart. So now, how do you determine the change happens or not? For that, I'm saying we are using the Q-sum process. And the Q-sum, we will use this equation. So for n number of points, we want to determine whether there is a change happens or not. Let's say our test case is at the kth point, we want to determine there might be a change happen. So potential candidate SKN, we want to estimate the log likelihood ratio. So this is the after change point and before change point. So if this value is higher than particular threshold, then we may say that this is a change is happening. So we may need to retrain the model. So this is the basic idea we use here. And we try to improve the algorithm perform. So this is the actually, the change detection algorithm is computationally very expensive and is our VM to the power cube. So cubic complexity we have. So for that, we try to, that means we cannot apply the change detection in the stream change detection algorithm for every test instances. So what we do? So we apply the change detection invoke selectively based on the confidence score for each test instance. If the confidence is very low, then we will apply the change detection. If the high, then we will ignore it. So these are the simplest. And then we have some other things try to improve the algorithm performance. These are simple heuristic we apply. And then also when you apply the change detection algorithm, we observe that it is there is a scope. You can apply the dynamic programming to improve the performance. So we apply the dynamic programming, and that way we reduce the complexity from order of cube to square. And we got some result I want to tell you. So the result will be reported in terms of error and false negative, false positive, those type of things. And these are the data set we used in the past, forest cover, you see I get it, some of the data set we got it, and the last two data set I think are synthetic. And you can see we are not considering only two classes, we are considering more than two classes, and the number of features are like this. And then here is the result. You can say the ECS miner is our former work, and this is the that uses the fixed chunk size, and ECO is our work that uses a dynamic chunk size or adaptive chunk size. And these are the famous Hoffman tree that has been used in the stream, and these are their error, and these are the Dr. Gamma's and Biffert's group's work. So we compared our approach with those, and you can see here the result is the error is the lowest in our case. And then we try to show you if we use the and then we try to show you the result for the novel class detection and forest cover and PAMAP data set we use, and ECS miner detects the novel class. The rest of the other baseline approaches do not detect the novel class. So, in our case the novel class m nu is how many novel class instances will be misclassified as existing class, and the f nu is the false alarm. So, you can see our result is a comparable or better than the ECS miner. And then I try to tell you that we did some work in the stream mining area when you have a limited level data. How do you want to address that issue? I want to touch that work a little bit. So, typically when you need to update the model, the assumption is this is the chunk and the chunk size is 1000 instances. The assumption is those 1000 instances will have the ground truth and you will build the model. But in real life in the stream that might not be possible, only maybe 10% data may have the ground truth or level data out of 1000. So, out of 1000 maybe only 100 points may have the ground truth. So, how do you want to address that issue? So, for that we can use the semi-supervised clustering algorithm, or we can use the active learning, those type of things we applied. And in this work when we use the adaptive chunk size, the idea is if we see that classifier confidence, classifier is very confident, and then we will not ask the human to provide the level. So, that's the simple way we can save lot of leveling process. Okay, now I want to talk about a little bit the application of the stream mining work. Okay, so application can be think about there are in security we tried some of the applications insider threat detection. There are some work in the malicious URL detection there they apply the stream mining work, and then website fingerprinting. I'll talk about that in a minute. So what is the website fingerprinting is an traffic analysis, but the idea is the traffic is encrypted and you want to detect what are the websites the user is accessing and so on. So, for example, what I meant this. Let's say this is a user or client who wants to access www.cnn.com, and he will send the request and the response will come. But this the traffic will be encrypted, and this they may use the Tor network. No way you can see the content, and even some cases you may not be able to see the IP addresses. Even if you see the IP addresses, it may not be useful due to the Tor network. And you are the attacker. You want to identify what websites the client is accessing, and there is a potential application. Think about it has a double sword. You can think about if you are an attacker is an authoritarian government, he wants to prosecute his citizen. So, he wants to monitor let's say the government wants to monitor if the citizens access 5-6 websites what the government thinks that the bad website. So, in that case they can prosecute them. On the other hand, it can be used in a good way. Say if you are if the client is a terrorist, if you want to identify the terrorist, so that you can do it also. And so on. So, now how we want to address that issue? So, the issue is you cannot see the traffic, you can see the traffic, but that will be encrypted. So, it will not be useful in terms of the content. So, only thing attacker can recognize the packet length and the flow information and so on. So that may be useful for the decision making. And here you can say that for we may have a billions of websites. So in this case, if you do the once you extract those features, say the packet size and the flow information, and then build the classifier and try to predict. But if you have a billions of websites, this method will not work. So the idea here is attacker will only target a few websites, monitored website, 5-6 websites. So in that case, that whatever the classifier you will build, that may work. So now the question is how this is associated with the stream mining. Keep in mind that the website server that you want to access, monitored website you want to access, that may change frequently. So for example, wwcnn.com, this is a news website, they will update their content frequently. So in that case, whatever the model you will build here, that needs to be updated. If you do not update frequently, then the attacker will not be able to identify the monitored website correctly and so on. So this is the problem. So there we need stream mining work. And then we did some work, duplicate detection over the textual news stream. The idea is this. This is the two articles. And you can think about these two articles are basically duplicates. And this is very, we get a lot of atrocity data set, and there are a lot of duplicates are there, and these are textual stream. So our goal is to identify those duplicate reports over the textual stream. Now, think about duplicate may happen. So these are the day one, day two, day three, the data are coming. And so duplicate may happen within a particular day. Duplicate may happen across the day one, day two, day three, something like this. But there may not be any duplicate from with respect to day one instance and the day 10 instance. So here what we do, we have for duplicate detection, you can use unsupervised learning. But here we use supervised learning, but in a different way. So we have a training data. We have a bunch of ground truth. So we have a training data means those reports. So we'll extract the features. Feature means in this case, we extract the bag of words. Then we use the Stanford Core NLP parser to extract the organization name, then the person name, then also the locations using Kevin Clip from MIT. So those tools will give you a bunch of features. And then the idea is here we want to determine whether two documents are duplicate or not. So what we will use, we'll take two documents, and if they're A and B, let's say if they're duplicates, we will say is a duplicate level. I mean, we'll say that is a duplicate equal to yes. And if A and C are not duplicate, then the class level will be zero. So that way, we'll generate the ground truth, and then we will build the model. And then when the test data comes, we will have in this case, test data will have two documents. I want to predict whether they are duplicate or not. So it will come here. And so the key point here is that for this, how the stream mining will be useful, because we observed that once you build the model at the beginning, because it's a chunk by chunk or day by day, in this case, at the beginning, we may not have enough training data. So we need to update the model continuously and so on. So for that, we do the change detection. And then also characteristics data may change over time and so on. So we have, I'll talk about that. I don't think I have that much time. So, and in the past, we did some work on the real-time anomaly detection using Apache Spark and Storm. And we have showed that real-time performance can be achieved using Apache Spark. And then, how many minutes? Okay, and then in future, I think you can, there are a couple of issues we try to solve in future. One issue is, so far I always assume that only one stream you have, but if you have a multiple stream, how do you want to address that issues? And some streams are labeled, some may not. And so in that case, if you have a multi-stream scenario, how do you want to tackle the, so one stream may have the ground truth, and another stream may not have, so you have to do some transfer learning. So that type of thing we try to do, and we have a paper this year at CIKM. so that we try to address it here. And then adversarial active learning might be useful. If your opponent wants to learn what you are doing, then you have to continuously update your model. So these are the issues. There is a, and this is a, in the cybersecurity area, this is a very important area. So we haven't addressed that issue. And then our, I said our change detection algorithm is still computationally expensive, and we for each test instance, we never applied that change detection algorithm. We apply change detection algorithm in a selective manner. So, and these are the references. So that's it. Do you have any questions?